In this lecture, we are going to better understand this process of translation from virtual addresses to physical addresses. Right, let's start with a simple example. Suppose you've written a C program and it has some function like this, which takes the value of, initializes a variable integer to be 3000 and adds 3 to it. Right, so this program gets compiled as follows into assembly code. So it's okay if you don't understand assembly language, but you basically have instructions like this. Your executable will have instructions like this. At address 128, you have an instruction that says move a certain location of memory into a register. The next instruction, so as you can see, each instruction is this instruction is 4 bytes. So 4 bytes later, you have another instruction that says add some number 3 to this register value. And there's another instruction that says store back this value in the register into memory, right? So this function is compiled into 3 such assembly language instructions. And these instructions have certain addresses. At address number 128 is this move L instruction and so on. Okay. Now, all of these instructions, they form part of your memory image, right? They are located at various addresses in the program code, and your memory image at certain other addresses, it has, objects that you've malloced in the heap. It has a few other variables. For example, you can see this variable X with the value 3000 is actually on the stack. Why? Because it is a local variable in a function, right? So this is on the stack. So as you can see, your memory image of the process has several pieces of code and data at different locations, at different addresses, right? This is the virtual address space of the process, right? So this is created by the operating system while it is setting up the process. It loads the code from the executable, from the disk, allocates a heap, allocates a stack, and so on. And this memory image, this virtual address space, is managed by the operating system. Anytime you want more memory on the heap, we've seen in the last lecture that you can make a few system calls, get more memory into this memory image anytime you want, right? So this is your virtual address space. Now what happens? Suppose all of these memory images placed into some part of your physical memory starting at address 32 KB. Okay. So in real life, you may not place all of it as one chunk in one place. You might place it at different parts. We've seen with paging, you'll split this into smaller chunks and distribute them all over the RAM. But for now, assume all of that goes in as one chunk starting at 32 KB. So now, you need the following translation from virtual address to physical address. If the CPU says, fetch me the instruction at address 108, what do you want? You want the actual physical hardware, the memory hardware, to see the address 32896, which is basically 32 KB plus 128, right? 32 KB plus 128. That is the address you want the memory hardware to see. So the CPU will say, fetch address 128, but you want a translation to happen to something else. Similarly, if the CPU says fetch whatever is there at 1 KB, you want the memory hardware to actually go fetch something that is at 33 KB. And if the CPU says fetch something at 20 KB, which is way beyond the address space of the process, if the CPU says fetch something at 20 KB, you want the memory hardware to say, sorry, you are way beyond your means. You don't want to fetch something from beyond the address space of the process, right? So you need these translations to happen. So who performs these address translations? In a very simple scheme, like what we've seen, where the entire memory image of a process is placed in one location in memory, the operating system can tell the memory hardware two values. It can tell it the base and the bound. That is, it can say, this process is located starting from address 32 KB in RAM, and it extends up to 16 KB. That is the size of its address space. You can tell the hardware two values. And then the hardware, the memory management unit, can do the translation as follows. It can take the virtual address. If you say, I want to access 1 KB, piece of data located at address 1 KB, and your base is 32 KB, then you can actually, the physical hardware should go to address 33 KB and fetch that piece of code or data for you, right? So this is a simple translation that the MMU can do. And the MMU will also check if whatever you're asking is out of bound. That is where this bound register comes into picture, right? So this base value is added to every virtual address and the bound value is checked to ensure that you're not going out of the bound of your address space. And note that all of this translation, this adding the base to the virtual address, all of this on every memory access is done by the MMU, which is part of your RAM. But the operating system is not involved in every translation. All the operating system does is provide these base and bound values to the MMU. Right? So to understand, let's summarize. The two things are involved, the operating system and the memory hardware, the MMU, both are involved in address translation. Let's understand who does what. First, the hardware should be able to provide a privileged mode of execution, right? We've seen this in a previous lecture where the CPU has multiple modes of execution. In user mode, it is in a less privileged mode, and in kernel mode, it is in a more privileged mode. Why? Why do you need a privileged mode of execution? Because the instruction set needs to have certain privileged instructions to set this translation information in the hardware, right? You don't want every process to be able to decide, hey, this is my base, this is my bound, and so on. You want only the operating system to be able to set these values. So the hardware should provide a privileged mode of execution, and it should provide certain instructions for the operating system to set this translation information. For example, there should be an instruction to set the base value, an instruction to set the bound value, and so on, right? And these should be privileged instructions. Only the operating system should be able to use them. And then the hardware, the MMU, will use this information to perform address translation on every memory access. The role of the OS is only to provide these base bound values, to provide whatever information is needed for the translation. But on every access, the hardware automatically does the translation. And finally, there's another important thing the hardware has to do. It has to generate faults. If the user does something bad, he accesses an address that is beyond his bound, then the hardware should generate a fault. It should generate a trap to the operating system so that the operating system comes into play. The process that is running stops. If you try to do anything bad, if the process tries to do anything bad, the MMU will generate a trap. The process stops, it goes into kernel mode, the operating system code is executed, and the operating system can take whatever action it wants. It can, for example, terminate the process if it accesses something that it shouldn't, and so on, right? So this is the role of the hardware in the address translation. So what is the role of the operating system? The operating system keeps track of what all is there in the memory, right? So if this is your physical memory, the operating system knows, okay, here is some code, here is the code of some other process, here is something else, here is something else, here is some free space, right? The operating system knows all of that of physical memory. And whenever a process starts up or makes a system call, requests for more memory, the operating system allocates memory to processes. And it keeps track. It maintains information of where space is allocated, right? Oh, this process asked for a page of memory and I gave it a certain page at so and so address. It remembers that information. And this information is stored as part of, say, the PCB of every process. And it provides this information, this address translation information, to the hardware, right? It tells the hardware, hey, here is, for this process, here is where its memory is located. For example, the base and bound is provided to the hardware. Another important thing, this information, the base and bound, or any other information of where a process is located in memory, this has to be updated on every context switch. Anytime you stop running a process, you switch to some other process, you have to update the hardware. Hey, you were using this base and bound value of process A earlier. Now I've switched to process B. Please update your base and bound value. And finally, anytime a trap or something happens due to illegal memory access, the operating system handles that as well, right? So the operating system is sort of like the brain, right? It keeps track of where each process is located, where it has allocated memory for processes, and so on. And this information is supplied to the hardware so that on every memory access, the CPU keeps issuing load, store instructions continuously. For all of those instructions, the operating system doesn't have to get involved. It's just provided the information to the hardware. The MMU does the translation on every memory access. And finally, let's what we've seen, the base and bound was a very simple scheme of allocating memory where you put the entire memory image of a process as one continuous chunk in memory. So a slightly more complex scheme, let's study a slightly more complex scheme, which is called segmentation, right? This is just a generalized way of looking at the base and bounds approach, where you don't place the entire process's memory image as one chunk, one contiguous chunk in memory. Instead, you place the code, heap, stack, all of these separately as smaller chunks into RAM. And here, the operating system has to track not one base and bound, but multiple base and bound values. For the code segment, here is where it starts and here is where it ends. For the heap segment, for the stack segment, and so on. Right? So we are not going to study segmentation in a lot of detail because this is not a very popular method these days. Right? Most modern operating systems use paging that we're going to study in the next lecture. But this is just to introduce you to the idea of segmentation. So why is segmentation good? It is good for sparse address spaces. If you have a lot of unused memory in your address space, right? You have a large amount of virtual address space provided to you, but you only use some part of it. You only have a small amount of code and data. There's no reason why this entire 16 KB should be, a chunk of 16 KB should be given to you in memory. Instead, you can simply place each of the smaller chunks where you actually have some useful data residing separately into memory, right? So this is good for sparse address spaces. But there's a problem with segmentation, which is because you're placing these smaller chunks into memory, you might have something called fragmentation, which is there might be some gaps in between these smaller chunks in the RAM, which are too small to be useful, but they result in wastage of memory, right? So which is why segmentation is not that popular these days, because it leads to fragmentation. After some time, your memory is just filled with a lot of these segments here and there, with a lot of small gaps between these segments.